highlight the recap of what's been going on today. I'm your host, Ryan Davitsky, the Sports Information Director here at Keystone College. I'm also joined by co-host Adrian Malott, the president of the Alumni Association here at Keystone. And also a special shout out to Elaine O'Connor for helping organize this event. Adrian, a few words from you.
Yeah, thank you, Ryan, and thank you everyone for joining us today. Also, thank you, Coach Higgins, and your staff for joining us today. First, I just wanted to say quickly what the Alumni Association is. So we are a group of people, Keystone graduates specifically, that get together, and our main goal is to engage alumni. So this is one of the events that we like to participate in and we like to sponsor, just to get everyone on the same page and keeping up with Keystone College and specifically today, Keystone football. So today during this event, please just pay close attention because we do have some great prize opportunities. So specifically listen to what Coach Higgins mentioned and also his fellow coaches. And then hopefully at the end of today, you can win a few prizes.
Thanks, Adrian. Right now we want to introduce head football coach, Justin Higgins. Justin, how's the experience been building this program from the ground up since you were hired back in 2018?
A great challenge, but a great experience with that. We knew going in that it was going to be a process and, knew that it wasn't going to happen right away. Anytime you get a chance to build something new and, especially, not many people get a chance to build an NCAA Division III football program. That's something for us that's very exciting. And we want to make sure we did and went about it the right way. I'm going to share quick kind of our mentality as we went in to it, just because, again, as you build a new program and you want to make sure you build that foundation and set the culture the right way. So we went about things, probably a little bit differently than a lot of programs. We want to make sure that the experience was there. So when we brought in our recruits and we evaluate our guys, we really look at the quality of them as people, not necessarily just players. I mean, we have some excellent players. We're looking forward to competing on the field when we get a chance to do so officially, if you will, and looks like 2021 at this point, but we are excited for that opportunity. But in order to make this last and really kind of be a program that's going to be around and competing in the conference and doing the right things on and off the field, we really focused on, finding that character, the right fit for guys. And you can see up here, this is what we build on. You can see what our core is represented. But really the one thing that we live by in our program is the concept of one day, one brick. We want guys to come in and really kind of build off of that and understand. And what we mean by that, and it's more than just a motto for us, it's really how our guys, our staff, our coaches, our players, everyone associated with our program goes about it. It's the mentality where every day we want to come in and do something to better ourselves as a program, as an individual within the program, especially as you're new. Things aren't going to just come right away, whether it be we're talking about facilities, whether it be we're talking about growth within the conference, whether it be really just establishing your roster. I mean, again, you're coming in with a lot of freshmen, sophomores. So we want to make sure that they come in and really live by that, mantra of every day coming and doing something to build towards the foundation. So we lay that out for our recruits, when we first come in, when they first visit, we're pretty open book with our guys as they come to Keystone and what's to expect of the college and us as a program and really of being a new program. So this is kind of where we start when it comes to getting the guys in place and really building from there on that.
Good, thank you. And do you want to tell us what's your greatest memory from 2019?
Well, 2019, was an interesting year, as we kind of look at it, when it comes to just getting those guys together. We knew that we were all working towards the 2020 season. This fall was supposed to be that first on the field NCAA official season. With that being said, we knew we had the opportunity in 2019 to get them on the field and wanted to make sure that we were able to do so and gain experience, but also develop our guys. And development is really something that's big for us. We want to make sure that we can, again, grow them, especially last year in 2019 as a group of all, freshmen pretty much with a handful of sophomores. So we wanted to give them that opportunity. So last year when we were able to step on the field for, kind of the first time, if you will, unofficially, we played three JV games, three varsity games, and a junior college team. And again, why we did that is knowing in 2020 that we were going to come in to that full season at that point. We didn't want to just play, JV games, but we also didn't want to just play a full, 10-game season even prior to that. So that's something for us where we wanted to make sure that we were, set to go. The varsity games kind of gave us that ability to play the, 21-year-old, 22-year-old juniors and seniors. Sometimes you got to get your butt kicked a little bit so you know where you have to go. But we also wanted to make sure that we, went against teams, the junior college, the JV teams, just so we know that, we can play guys our same age, freshman, sophomore, so we can give them game experience. And I think our season went about when you look at, just coming up short our very first game when it was a JV game to then gaining experience versus a varsity. And then the third game of the season, going out and getting a win after we got a big lead and we're able to hold on to it. And even as it progresses throughout season and eventually, going down to someone's homecoming and kicking a game-winning field goal as time expired. It's always good when you do it on someone else's homecoming, especially, when they make you wear your practice jerseys. That's a whole different story. But that's always good when you get that opportunity in that. So, obviously there's a lot of great moments, with the kids on the field, but I think it's just, that growth that they've had throughout. And, we've got some good clips that I want to kind of show with everyone here, just with the highlight. So enjoy. It gives you a little bit of an idea of some things that we did on the field. So hopefully you can come across okay.
Yeah. I got love all around me, yeah, yeah. I'd be a fighter till the end, to my last breath. I'ma hustle to my last breath. I got angels all around me, yeah, yeah. I got love all around me, yeah, yeah. I'd be a fighter till the end, to my last breath. I'ma hustle to my last breath. I came from no quarter waters. Every day in my gang unemployed. Around you must want a gang war. I got a old girl and a transporter. Stepping is a habit, I got Zans on me. I'm riding in the flame, keep the fan on me. Catch me ripping the Mustang with them bands on me. I'ma kill the competition and I'm playing for keeps. You see water dripping off me, then catch it. I turn nothing into something, now I'm living. You neglected me, you know you shouldn't have did that. They was counting out, you know you shouldn't have did that. You didn't recognize my drive, shouldn't have did that. Now I'm fighting every day, I won't get back. I just wanna be the champ for the misfits and the one that was saying I couldn't do. I got angels all around me, yeah, yeah. I got love all around me, yeah, yeah. I'd be a fighter to the end, to my last breath. I'ma hustle to my last breath. I got angels all around me, yeah, yeah. I got love all around me, yeah, yeah. I need a fighter to the end, to my last breath. I'ma hustle to my last breath. Who knew I would take it to a whole nother level? Who knew I would race it with a heart of a rebel? Shout out one checking for me, mama.
So it gives you a little bit of always a little good football action on Saturday. We'll take it. We missed some of that this year. So but give you a chance to see some of those guys that came in 2019 flying around a little bit, and obviously looking forward to getting them back on the field again, hopefully soon.
That was a great video. Thank you for sharing. Talking about playing soon and being on the field again soon, could we talk a little bit about 2020? And you, can you just sort of tell us a little bit about what's going on?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, everyone, whether you're in, you know, football, athletics, or not at all, obviously has been affected during 2020. It's been an interesting year, and a lot of time, you know, a lot of transition, a lot of adapting, no matter what we do. So with us building towards 2020, you know, since we kind of implemented the program back in the beginning of 2018, you know, it was a little bit of a disappointment, obviously, as we had to tell the kids that we weren't going to be able to play that first season, that first inaugural season. But we were pretty upfront about where we were going to be at with the process while we were hoping to play. We were one of the, I think when we officially said we weren't playing, we were like 34 Division III teams left that were still fighting to play, and there's 250 of them. So we were really trying to find a way, but then, you know, just NCAA just made it a little more difficult to do that. So at that point, we just transitioned quickly into how do we make ourselves better. And I think, again, with the guys, whether we're talking about the 2019 guys that were back to be sophomores or even the 2020 guys that were coming in as freshmen, they quickly saw it as that opportunity of, as a young program, we might have the ability to grow more than a lot of other programs. Just because, again, we didn't have a full season last year. We didn't have a full off season, which you see the greatest, you know, gains between a freshman and a sophomore in spring. So they really, you know, along with that concept of, you know, one day, one brick, when I talk about they live by it, they took that right away into, okay, when we get to, you know, class, when we get to the field, when we get to the weight room, we can use that and really grow as a program. So we got them back to school, obviously got them in person with class as much as possible. We have a very extensive academic program with our guys. So we got them started right away in the semester, and then started getting them in the weight room and running on the field, and that progressed to practice. And obviously practice was a little different, you know, following the social distancing and COVID guidelines, but just to get them out there and active 6 out of 7 days a week, up through basically this past week when they started going home for Thanksgiving, we really grew, and you saw the team camaraderie and, you know, building, you know, what it's like being a teammate and building some leaders with, again, being a young team. You need to be able to do that. And then getting better, getting stronger, getting faster, working on our craft on the field, what we could. You know, it was enjoyable to watch them out there, because if anyone took a look and came out to our field, and, you know, we were talking in the beginning about how we've had really nice weather, which is great. But I think of one Thursday that was a cold rain, guys out there for 2 hours. You could not tell one bit that those guys, you know, weren't playing their first season. I mean, they just enjoyed being out there with each other and just getting better. And I think that's, you know, when you look at 2020, it's not ideal for anyone, but the way they adapted and kind of took to it and said, you know, we can get the most out of this. Let's go do it. I think is a detriment, you know, just this, you know, speak on how highly of a character of guys we have, and even being young, just the leaders that we have as well.
Yes, definitely. So you did touch on it a little bit, but how has COVID affected this young team, particularly that they are freshmen and sophomores mostly?
Sure. I think, you know, the biggest part, I guess, minus the games, and then obviously that's a big piece, but without playing games, we lost camp, our preseason camp, and for any fall sport, but obviously, especially with us, we get a chance to be in 2 weeks before school starts. So for 2 weeks, we really get to get them acclimated to campus, what we do from an academic standpoint, community service standpoint, but also get them working with each other and kind of work out some of the kinks of a freshman transitioning into college. And unfortunately, we lost that. So I think one of the biggest effects in terms of a potential negative or just a setback was we didn't have those 2 weeks just by ourselves on campus, which we usually do in August. And we saw that throughout. Some things were a little slower to develop from some of the off the field development academically, or just even, you know, kind of team structure wise. So I think that was maybe a potential setback. But I think then if you flip it, looking at us as a young program, you know, COVID, I think, created some opportunity for us that we can maybe be better off when we do, you know, set foot in 2021, you know, whether it be our players, whether it be overall program, you know, obviously facilities were slowed down when it came to COVID. So I think, you know, when you look at it and look back at it, while no one wanted this and everyone wanted to play, you know, we had 6 home games planned for this past year. So we were looking forward to getting out there. But I think when we go to 2021 in the fall and are looking to play that first game in that first season, I think we can look back at the year prior and say, you know what, we were able to build off of it and kind of turn it into a positive, at least some of it.
Yeah, thank you. What modifications did you actually have to make during practices or team lifts, team meetings, community service?
Yeah, so obviously the normal COVID guidelines, social distancing, masked, temperature check on any day that we did a physical activity like a lift, a run, or a practice, those were all implemented. We also had to watch numbers and you know, group sizes. You know, our weight room is, you know, designed where we can fit up to 24 guys in it. We usually like to get 12 to 16 to maximize the coaching in them, but we had to be limited to 6 guys in the weight room at a time. So we have to adjust to now just how are we going to do the lift and then minimize the amount of time they're inside because, you know, again, falling under the 15 minutes that's, you know, that you want to be there. So we had to adapt how we did our strength and conditioning program. Our on the field practice, you know, it wasn't necessarily your normal run around and tackling and scrimmaging. We really focused, we broke it down into 2 segments. In the first segment, we were working in groups of less than 10, you know, there's multiple groups at a time, but those groups worked within themselves, socially distant again, and did just drills and technique work. And we missed spring practice in Division III, NCAA Division III football. You don't get helmets and shoulder pads in spring practice, but it's still a time period that you can work on the real true fundamentals. You can go slow, kind of reteach. So we missed that. So we used segment 1 in the small groups to look at it like a spring. So we went out there and kind of taught for a lot of the freshmen the technique and just went, you know, really small attention to detail things. And then when we went into our segment 2, we still had to remain socially distant. We couldn't scrimmage or anything. But then we started introducing helmets and shoulder pads, and at least to get them out there running around, get used to having them on. We still could obviously do our drills against bags and sleds and use different equipment. Never could end up scrimmaging, but again, we knew that was a likelihood getting into this year. And again, you really couldn't tell throughout any of the times we were out there. Guys used it to maximize their time and to get better.
Right, good. So looking ahead, what are the current plans for the spring and for the fall coming up?
Yeah, we said all along with our guys that when unfortunately our season got canceled, despite there's a lot of things being thrown out there about, oh, maybe you can play in the spring, or, you know, maybe they'll adapt the schedule. We told our guys right away that the next time we're playing is fall of 21. And a big part of that is with obviously the disappointment of what this fall brought and really the unknown, even today, the unknown of what spring's going to be like. And obviously, you know, 3 months ago, the same thing. The last thing I wanted is to get their hopes up and have them working through this fall thinking they're going to play in the spring. And it doesn't mean if something ever changed and we had a bonus, and, you know, we would take it. But that's what made this fall really even more special. When you looked at those guys working, they were never thinking, oh boy, if we work hard now, we might play in March or April. You know, they knew that they were still prepping for a season 1 year away. So spring for us, we're hoping we can get back as normal and get right into our off season. Now the official off season, if you will, and we'll get into the weight room. We'll do some indoor agility pieces. I'm sure there'll be some guidelines in place and we're set for those. And then progress into a spring practice. Again, if we're allowed to use some helmets and shoulder pads, even if we're not making contact, that would be still great because we still get a chance to develop our guys. So we're looking at kind of a more normal, if you will, Division III football spring, and then really get our sights set for 2021 fall and get our guys ready for now, the first true official varsity season.
Good. We're excited to hear. So my last question that I have for you is, I know that there's a lot of changes and current construction projects up near the turf area.
Yep.
So could you just talk to us a little bit about your facilities?
Yeah, absolutely. And for with our facilities, again, anytime you add a program, and especially football, you know, you need to, you know, upgrade, add, you know, it brings a different dynamic. And, you know, ironically, we talk about the one day, one brick with, you know, our players and how to go about it. Well, building facilities is the same way. It takes time, unfortunately, and especially with COVID, you know, slowing us up a little bit. So these are some of the things from a football facility standpoint that we either have done or in progress right now, or are on their way. You know, pretty much all of these at least have been started, which is good. We did add an athletic weight room last summer. That got done in June, and that's for all sports and all athletes here at Keystone, which is nice. It's a nice little area, you know, very productive for really all teams to develop. We had to adapt the field, as everyone knows, obviously having soccer and lacrosse, the turf field is up there in a great condition, but we had to get lines on it, for football, which we ended up painting on instead of trying to go through and redo and sew in. It's a permanent paint that we touch up every year. We had to get goalposts. I remember the day that we finally got our goalpost in. I was like a little kid at Christmas. I tell our guys all the time, I drove up. You never thought someone who'd been coaching over 20 years football would get so excited about seeing goalposts put on a field. But I remember driving home that night and pulling off the side of the road. On the road I live, you can see the field from there, and took a picture of the goalpost. You know, that's kind of what point was. And obviously, we need to expand the stadium bleachers. We got a new scoreboard this year, and then our locker room complex being built. And, these are some of the pictures that you'll see. So this is our weight room right here. It's got six racks with inlaid platforms in it. And it's down in what used to be the old maintenance garage. It did a great job renovating, and it's part of a building that has baseball and softball locker rooms in it and a team meeting room / multi-purpose room in it. So this is very high functioning for all our sports in it, good space in there. So you can kind of get an idea of what our weight room is about. And our guys have been in it and a lot, same with a lot of sports, you know, since it got done last summer and really making good use out of it. We talked about kind of the turf field and the press box and stadium expansion. So, you know, for those that are familiar with our field, you understand when you look at kind of the smaller blue press box and the bleachers that were already there, and even for those that are not, with obviously having the turf field prior, those were already in existence. And again, they weren't that old. Those bleachers were about 4 years old. So we wanted to try to be as efficient as possible. We understood that present press box, the smaller one, from a functioning standpoint, just wasn't going to work for football. We need it higher up. We have more coaches in the press box, both sides. We have filming, but we also didn't want to go and tear down the old bleachers. We didn't want to ruin the integrity from a functioning standpoint, and as well as from a visual standpoint of the retaining wall that's there. It's got a unique touch to our field, which we like. So we ended up this past fall, late summer, early fall, putting in the new press box that you can see here, along with that upper section of the bleachers, and then we'll get access to it from the stairs that you see going up. We're currently, and you can actually see the excavator in the background, which again, always good progress when you see the construction equipment, but they're running water and power right now to the new field house, which I'll show you. At that time, we'll take the fiber and the electric, and we'll run it from the old press box into the new, and then that old press box will be removed, but we'll keep the bleachers. And then you can kind of see, and then they're cut off a little, but we've got a lot of room laterally, both top and bottom of that retaining wall to kind of during the phase two, expand our bleachers that way. So it's going to create a one side grandstand, but we did it a little bit different because of what was already there and to kind of keep the look, which we all like. You know, again, it's a unique setting. We want to keep it that way. We talked about the field, you know, kind of getting it ready, the turf adapting, getting the lines in, getting the, you know, goalposts in. We got our new scoreboard again this fall, which is nice, you know, good size and obviously adapted to the addition of football with it as well. And then we have our field house, and the field house is going to be basically our locker room complex off the one end. You can see it in progress right now. So we've got our locker rooms will be on one side, and then on the other side, there'll be seasonal locker rooms for men's and women's lacrosse, soccer, field hockey, and as well as guest locker rooms. And then there'll be a president. The second floor is going to be a president's room suite. I don't know, best way to call it, I guess, and just get them up there and possible for games. So obviously we were affected a little bit with COVID on that. And, you know, just general building timelines always, you know, when you go to build something new, you're always going to run into some sort of delays. So we're excited to hopefully get our guys in there in the spring to you see the locker rooms are, excuse me, the lockers are on site, but they have not been installed yet. So we're hoping that once things kind of die down a little bit and normal becomes, you know, hopefully normal, we get back to that, that we can start using it, not only us, but all the, turf teams.
Good.
Justin, thanks a lot for sharing the slideshow and the videos. I know there's a few in attendance today. I know a few are on the road recruiting, but can you introduce your great assistant coaching staff too?
Absolutely. You know, and before I get to who, and I'm going to have some of them introduce themselves, you guys have heard from me probably enough, you know, but we do a lot with our guys, you know, off the field as well. When we recruit our guys, we talk that while we have fun for the 2 hours on the field, it's the 22 hours, you know, outside of that we really want to focus on developing our guys. And, you know, all our recruits come in knowing that, you know, we're going to be very involved in that. And a big part of that is obviously the staff. And, you know, you can't go anywhere as a program if you don't have a great coaching staff. And we have a tremendous one. You know, obviously, as you build the program, you build your coaches coming in. Two of them actually are on the road today recruiting at a showcase. Hugh Kerwin. He was our most recent addition, came last spring, right around the time of COVID. So I give him a hard time that I blame him a little bit for when we went on break, you know, on that. But Hugh coaches our wide receivers, went to Marist. So I know one of our other, you know, coaching staff members is happy about that we added a Marist grad on as one of our assistants. You know, so he does a tremendous job. He coached and taught down in Florida high school wise. Prior to that, he's from New Jersey himself. And then our other assistant who's not here is Bailey Faldetta. Bailey actually, and he came on last August. So this, you know, this would be the second fall that he's coached with us. Bailey actually played for me at Morrisville when I was the defensive coordinator. So Bailey, when he was a freshman and sophomore, played for me. So he knew what he was getting into, I always joke about. So, you know, and he was still wanted to come. So, which we really appreciate. And he coaches our defensive backs. And again, those guys are at a showcase. And then we've got our three other assistants on the call now. So on the Zoom now. So I'll turn it over to them to let them introduce themselves.
All right. Hi, guys. I'm Dom Guglielmo. I coach the offensive line, and I'm also the recruiting coordinator. I'm from Northern New York, went to SUNY Brockport, kicked off my coaching career out in Duluth, Minnesota, then took a trip down to Tiffin, Ohio, and for the last almost 2.5 years, I've been here with Coach Higgins and getting the program here started. It's been awesome.
How you doing, guys? Dontavious Smith here. Offensive coordinator. I also work with quarterbacks and running backs. Military kid, so I've kind of been all over the place, but home for me is Warner Robins, Georgia. Went to high school at Northside High School, went to college at Georgia Southern. Kicked off my career coaching in Georgia. I'm at a high school for four years. Unique opportunity to go to Atlanta and start a program. So that's what made this even more special for me here. And then I got started in college football in 2012 down at Widener University in Chester, PA. Then took a trip back to my home and then took a trek out to Iowa, coached at Waldorf University there, and then went down to Texas and experienced 2 years of college football down there. And then when I interviewed with Coach Higgins, I got the opportunity to come here and build this with him. And I love the ride ever since. I'm glad to be here.
My name is Andrew Kolb. I'm the other guy on staff here. I coach defensive line. I'm originally from the Lehigh Valley, just about an hour south of here or so. I went to college at Temple University, and then I got my coaching. I started coaching high school ball, and then I got my college coaching career started off at East Charleston University. I was there for about 2 years, left there to become a grad assistant at Wagner College over in Staten Island. And then I've been here almost 2 years now. Come January, we'd be two full years here, and then yeah, keep going through.
Great, thanks guys. Just a few questions for you. First, what areas and states do you guys focus on recruiting? I guess we'll start with Dom and then Dontavious and Andrew.
My recruiting area is District 1 and 12, so the Philly and the surrounding area. Central Jersey. Also recruit the homeland of Northern New York, and then sections basically Western New York.
I touch on PA 11 and 3. I also recruit Northeast New Jersey. So that's fun. Always going up there, rubbing elbows with those guys. And then I do New York City and Long Island, Nassau County, is where I get our guys from.
I focus a lot. There's 11 in Pennsylvania, Jersey Shore, and the Long Island, kind of my areas I go for.
Thanks, guys. A few more questions here for you. This one's for Dom. How do you pinpoint certain recruits? What do you actually look for?
I think after we reach out to all the high school coaches and compile our database and really start reaching out to kids, I think it's what we really focus on is fit. I mean, we know Keystone College, we're in a unique situation. We're building a program. Our core, which Coach Higgins spoke about earlier, is huge. So when we're trying to pinpoint the guys that we want to recruit, we're talking to the coaches, see if they fit our ideals. Are they high character? All that kind of stuff. Are they going to be a part of building the program? Do they want to roll up their sleeves and build this thing one day at a time? And naturally, are they going to be academically successful? Like, we want to have the guys that are really high character and the guys that are going to take the academic seriously and want to get coached on your character and academically. And then, of course, we want good football players. But notice how that was the last thing we really hit on is we want the right fit first. And then the football really comes after that.
Thanks, Dom. Question for Dontavious. What kind of scheme are you guys going to run offensively here at Keystone?
Scheme-wise, when you talk about that, which me and Coach Higgins sat down in our interviews trying to figure out, you know, when you're building a program, what do you run to fit who you bring in? You know, when you're starting a program, you don't have the luxury of picking and choosing everybody that you want. So it was big for us to come in and say, what is our base? Which is where we're spread based, and what we want to start with it, which is inside zone and our RPO game. But we want to be able to also transition and fit the guys that we bring in. So we're multiple on offense and formation wise. We also use a ton of personnel so that we can have our guys excel on the field. So if we're able to fit almost like a one size fit all type deal, is being able to play to the strengths of the guys that we have on our offense. So I'll say spread principle, but we're multiple We tell our guys we want to play fast, we want to be physical, but we also want to be explosive. And we can fit that to our guys, we feel like we'll have a good chance of being successful on Saturday.
Thanks, Dontavious. Question here for Andrew. How are you using social media to engage the recruits?
Well, first off, social media is kind of where like our target, like those recruiting age kids, they spend most of their time on social media. That's where they see all the content. And with Keystone being a new program, I kind of started off with just putting content out there, just know that, all right, Keystone has football, make sure that they're aware of it. And then kind of just showing them love from there after that, make sure that they see the graphics, they see all different, the pictures of our athletes all on there. And I know all our own athletes, they love seeing themselves on social media. They love seeing themselves on these graphics. And with the recruits, they kind of, the thought process is, all right, they're seeing all these graphics that their athletes are getting. I want to be part of it. I want to be part of those graphics. I want one of my own. And that's kind of how we're using that social media and the whole graphic with the Twitter and everything like that, trying to engage our recruits and, again, just kind of make sure they're aware of Keystone and just making sure that just put content as there as possible. So when they hear Keystone, they know we're all about.
Thanks, Andrew. A few more questions here for the assistants. Many of the players have shared their stories and experiences with some individuals across campus. One shared an experience that they all feel part of a family. Why is incorporating those values and that atmosphere so important to you?
I think it's a big thing is having a family atmosphere brings that trust into the equation. I mean, the guys have to trust you to a parents have to trust you to send their kids to play for you and go to school. But the kids have to trust that you're there for them and their social development, their academic development, their athletic development. So really focusing on the family aspect is really builds that trust with the guys that they know that we're here for them, that everything that we do as a coaching staff and the message that we bring to them as a coaching staff is to benefit them both on and off the field. And it makes things, and on the other side, it makes things a lot more fun when they can let their guard down a little bit and call Coach Slime and joke around and have a good time. Like, that's the other aspect of what the family atmosphere brings.
And to go on what Coach G is saying, building that atmosphere is awesome. Being able to look left and right and know you can trust and believe in those guys in the locker room with you, not only on the field, but in the classroom, that they're going to do things right. And that's what we kind of drive home is, I tell our guys and when they first had our first offensive meeting, I said, hey, I adopted 40 plus kids, you know, and I'm here for them. And we want them to know that we love them and we care about them. Not just, again, not on the field, but off the field, you know, in their home life. And when you bring that aspect to a program, those kids believe in what you're saying. They feel it. And when you can display it to them as well, then it only makes it a better experience, not only for us, but for them as well. And they're reaching out. And the best thing about it is when they're reaching out to their friends and saying, hey, it's like a family here. And they can really and attest to that and give stories about it. And Coach G is probably the one that could tell you about it because we call him the counselor. Because a lot of kids talk to him a lot, you know. But just to be able to let them know that we do care and we extend ourselves to them more than just on the field, it goes a long way and help building the culture and the what we want as a program.
And the fact that making this a family, make sure that they care about these kids, it makes the job more fun. Like, we do other things outside of football. Where a couple of times last year, like non-COVID time, we go play pickup basketball with them. A couple of times we went bowling with the kids. A bunch of assistant coaches went bowling, played arcades with the kids, and hung out with them that way. And I know I've had a little Madden League with the kids too. So it's something to do with the kids, hang out, makes the job much more enjoyable. And plus, it gives you a lot more other things to talk about outside of practice. It's not all work, it's not all business with your kids. It makes that relationship with them even more enjoyable because you have other things to talk about and you actually care for them outside of the field.
Thanks for that answer. one last question for you three. What's it like to coach under Justin Higgins?
It's kind of fun. I'll say that. I'll start. All three of us are looking at each other in our Zoom call. Before I took this job, I did a lot of, because you always want to know who you're working for. And you hear all these stories about a coach, and they're like, and out of all the guys, because Coach Higgins is, we're from a similar area in New York, and and the only thing I ever heard about him was Justin is Justin. And you don't really know how to take that, but then you get here and you interview with him and you work for him, and it's actually pretty fun. He cares about the guys. He cares about us. His family's awesome. You get to see all four of them and their moose dog running around practice, and I don't know, it's a fun atmosphere. I mean, I have no complaints, and it's not just because he's on the call. but yeah, it's been pretty fun.
Is your job on the line? no, I'm right there with you. When I first interviewed, before Don did, talk with Coach Higgins, I felt like it was a great fit. When he first told me he had four kids, and I said, great, because I got four. So we were right there together, you know. And then he brought me in. But working for him has been fun. He talks about the process a lot, and to work for a guy that's as detailed as he is. Even talking to him over the summer with the whole COVID deal, you know, he laid out a ton of plans of if this happened, if that happened, if this happened. And I told him, you know, I said, man, you sound like you're built for this, you know. And that's what it is. When you have a guy that a head coach that can think 4, 5, 7, 8 steps ahead, if things change, you know that you have somebody that you can follow. You know, you're not going to be lost. You know, you're going to have, this is going to happen 1, 2, 3, X, Y, Z, and you know it's going to get done. And coming here with him has been fun. You know, he's gonna test you. He's gonna make sure that your convictions and your beliefs in what you're saying, even from an offense standpoint, is what it is. And I've grown a lot from it. You know, I've looked at myself and added some things that, you know, you didn't gain in the past. So that's what you want in a head coach, is somebody's gonna help you grow and move forward. And that's what I've gotten since I've gotten here.
Yeah, he's kind of like, he's definitely, I thought he's definitely a coach that's not a traditional head coach. He's the type of head coach that leads from the front, where we're doing all this grunt work and he's there, we're doing it with us. Where I've worked with places in the past where they kind of delegated to us, where he's out there doing all this stuff with us, counting the jerseys or whatever it may be, he's there helping us with it. And like he definitely said before, bring that whole family thing, is he definitely kind of takes us in as one of his own. I know Bailey's not here right now, but he kind of dubbed him as the oldest son, but he does treat all his young coaches here like part of his family and make sure he does take care of us like as much as possible, brings us food, make sure we're eating and everything. So definitely does take care of us real well.
Thanks guys. Thanks for sharing those. I know that was the tough one on the spot.
Yes. Thanks guys. So the next segment is about the players. So I know that the players right now with the time of year and them heading home for the holidays, that it's a little difficult to get, you know, some players to join us today. But I do know that you have a clip to show us about the players and their experiences at Keystone College. So if you can share that.
Yeah, absolutely. One, I appreciate the staff. I know that last one's a tough one. So that's why, you know, recently buy them dinner and that usually comes out pretty good. No, joking aside, you know, as we transition into the players, I think you'll see a lot of what they talked about and a lot of what I mentioned about our staff being kind of integral with them. You know, they mentioned and our guys have done a great job. We've thrown a lot at them this fall. We have not backed down from our expectations. And so when they had a chance to kind of get home, I didn't require them to stay today and jump on the Zoom. But throughout their time here, we have put together the coaching staff. Coach Cole has put together a lot, you know, video and collected kind of archive with them. And so we want you to get a chance to meet them. And while they won't be necessarily on the Zoom call, you'll get an idea of a handful of our guys, you know, who are on our team. Just give you a little of their background, and where they're from, and you'll see some football plays as well. You know, here are a few of our guys, and once again, enjoy.
I like Keystone College because it feels like home. I came from a small town, and this has a small town vibe. The classrooms are smaller. You get to know a lot of more people that way. You get to create a connection with the professors rather than a bigger school.
Hi, my name is Adam Fafdi. I'm a sophomore here at Keystone, majoring in criminal justice and psychology. I play defensive line. Keystone means a lot to me. I've learned many things here, especially in my field of criminal justice and psychology. I've met many great friends, some of which I believe are going to be lifelong, going to be with me for the rest of my life. Keystone has taught me to not settle for anything, push myself harder, and that means a lot coming from where I came in.
I'm Frankie Vega. I'm a sophomore here. I play linebacker. I like Keystone because of the family bond we build here. We're not just teammates on the field, we're also like best friends off the field. And just like yesterday, we went to the coach's house and we all hung out for a couple hours, shooting bows and shooting arrows and all that stuff. We're just hanging out, it's cool.
My name is Elijah O'Neill. My position on the field is linebacker. I'm a sophomore at Keystone College. And what has Keystone meant to me mostly has been it's helped in my academic career, how basically I can still pursue my career and get all the credits that I need and still have a good chance of going to a good graduate school afterwards while also still playing the sport I love. playing at Keystone College has been an amazing experience and has allowed me to make a lot of new friends and people I can call family, especially through the linebackers and other defensive players on the team. They welcome me from a very early start. And even though we haven't gotten to play this season, there's been a lot of team building and bonding, and it's very important to still be able to play and come together as a team, even though we're not playing. So it's been a great time.
Hi, my name is Andrew Rodriguez. I'm a wide receiver here at Keystone College. I'm currently a sophomore. I'm from Islip, New York, which is in Long Island. And I picked Keystone because not a lot of people can make history by starting up with a new team and having such a great community behind it. Keystone's meant a lot to me about this whole process during college. Not only have they allowed me to have a chance to play, a lot of teams overlook me. It's just been great academically because every teacher is here to support you and get you out of here in 4 years. And, you know, just enjoy every step of it. And on the football side of things, they really care about you. They care about you as a family. You know, you create amazing friendships, amazing brotherhoods that last for a lifetime. And yeah, it's been a hell of a ride. But really, Keystone is something that would hold dear to my heart because it's a once in a lifetime thing that you don't really get to play college football with a great group of guys and enjoy going to school every day because the teachers really just accept you and, you know, enjoy who you are. So, you know, Keystone would always be near and dear to my heart.
So we would love to be able to have you get introduced to all our guys. You know, we have some just great characters and great young men that we look forward to working with. But at least gives you a few of our guys. And, you know, hopefully the next time around, this is in person and they get a chance to be here in person. And kind of a side note, you know, with our guys and kind of who they are and what they represent, during our recruiting days, we actually offer a player panel to our recruits and our parents that come on campus, and we as coaches leave the room, you know, so we let them stand in there, sit in there, and players and parents will fire away questions at them. And, you know, you don't do that unless you know, you have the right guys and, you know, guys that have, you know, shown, you know, and represented, you know, our core and stuff. And we have a ton of them. So.
That's great. Thank you. And great video again. Thank you for sharing.
So I typed in the chat there. If you have any questions for Coach Higgins or the staff, feel free to put it in the chat room there for the Grill the Coach segment coming up next. Before we start that, a couple predetermined questions here. What are the current plans for the spring semester and Keystone football?
Sure. I think, you know, building off kind of what we talked a little bit before is just we want to come in looking to continue what we put in place this semester. And with a little bit extra time not seeing them, you know, with our students going home for Thanksgiving, working virtually after Thanksgiving than your normal holiday break, it's a little bit longer than normal. So when we get them back in spring, we want to make sure we get them on right track to start their semester off academically with everything that we do, and then getting them back, you know, from strength and conditioning standpoint, progressing hopefully to getting on the field in a normal spring practice.
What's the importance of connecting with the community?
I think it's huge. One, and really twofold. One, I think it's important for our guys to understand, you know, service over self and just getting out, whether it be campus or community service, and trying to get out there in the public. You know, the other side is we love the support from campus. We love the support from the community. So it would be unfair for us to ask for them to come and, hey, come watch our games and support us if we're not there for them. So we really stress the community service aspect, the campus service aspect of it. A lot of times it's more spring related just because of our normal season, but, you know, whether it be food and can drives, whether it be, you know, adopt a family through Salvation Army and our guys wrapping presents, which we still have to work on our wrapping skills. That's I'm going to have to buy more gift bags, I think. But, you know, there as they're working through that. I mean, even this year, you know, our fall wasn't normal. So Labor Day weekend, we had, you know, an extra weekend basically, because we started practice that Monday. So we set out and we kind of tagged it our Labor Day 100. Our goal was to get out in the campus and community and do 100 hours of community service. And we ended up doing 123 on a Saturday and Sunday, you know, in 2 days. So, you know, getting out in the community is really, really big for us.
How did your team stay competitive during fall practices?
You have to find new ways, you know, because some of the same drills that you would do that would be, you know, in a normal sense, you just don't have. You don't have them competing for the spot that's going to be starting on that following Saturday. There's the natural competing for, you know, the spot. They want to earn their spot in the depth chart. They want to prove themselves. But we have to find other ways to do it. You know, we had an outdoor ping pong tournament. We built ping pong tables that went over the picnic tables up at the pavilion. And we had a team weekend ping pong tournament just to see who could have bragging rights among the positions and, you know, among the whole team. You know, so, you know, whether it be that or, it, you know, on the field during practice, we would do competitive stations, you know, that were, again, socially distanced and all the proper guidelines, but getting them out there and competing, whether it be med ball throws or dizzy bat competitions or giant tic-tac-toe board, which we struggle sometimes with tic-tac-toe, you know, but they have a lot of fun with that, you know, so that's something that, you know, our guys really enjoy, and just any way that they can try to one-up the guy next to them is always fun.
And this is the last of the predetermined questions here. What are your plans for recruiting for fall 2021 via social media announcing incoming recruits?
So we're going to continue, you know, I think with what Andrew talked about earlier in terms of how important social media is, you know, that's something that we're going to continue on our track of what we normally do, along with obviously the in-person. You know, we've been lucky because we've still been able to have visits. And, you know, even with the more recent guidelines, we're still going to be able to have PA residents come on campus after Thanksgiving. So we want to make sure our in-person recruiting is still on point. We want to make sure that we get that personal touch that you hear a lot of the coaches talk about. You know, that starts in recruiting. That doesn't start when the players first get here. So we want to make sure we do that and then use the social media to piggyback that, to show updates and facilities, just to, you know, keep them engaged in what we're doing, throw something fun at them. Andrew does a great job coming up with some creative stuff to put out there. So that's something that we will continue with. And then obviously as that alters a little bit, if the landscape over the next couple months changes, you know, we're set to go in a couple different directions to use that as a bigger part of the platform if we need to, just based off where the guidelines end up going.
Great. Thanks, Coach. Now we're at the part of the tailgate here everyone's been waiting for, the Gorilla Coach segment. About 7 questions in there. If you don't have any more, feel free to share, everyone on the chat here. First question from Doreen. What's the capacity of the new stadium and the new bleachers?
That's a great question, because we're looking to add some more seats flanking those right now. So I do not have the exact number that it's going to be coming for fall. We're looking to build off what you saw there. And then part of that will also, as the new press box comes off, the old press box comes off. We're going to replace that either with just a platform or maybe some seating there. So we're looking to definitely, from what you saw, look to expand. We also want to, on the lower sections, have picnic tables available, kind of like family picnic table seating. So they're going to be down the wet line from, you know, on either side compared to the main seating area. So we're going to look to gain more seats than even what you see with it.
Next question comes from our head field hockey and women's lacrosse coach, Ashley Irwin. Who's your favorite sports hero?
Ooh, sports. That's a great one. I guess I don't know if I have a favorite. Growing up, I was a huge Tom Landry fan. If we want to stick to kind of coaches and football, I think that was, you know, that was someone that, you know, being a Cowboy fan. And, you know, when I started liking them, that was towards the end of Tom Landry years. So that was a little bit of a struggle, but just to see how he went about his business. So I would say I'm a huge Tom Landry fan. You know, would read books on Bear Bryant. Though some of those practices aren't allowed these days, you know, when you watch Junction Boys and stuff like that. But I would say from a coaching standpoint, I think that was a lot of, you know, from those guys. And I always like just anytime you're talking about athlete or a coach, just seeing those competitive people, you know, whether or not a fan, like I never was a Michael Jordan fan because I was a Knick fan. So you couldn't obviously like Michael Jordan, but watching his competitive greatness, you know, and how he rose above, you know, just watching. So it never became kind of a one single athlete or one single coach, but just watching in a lot of different scenarios, how guys handle themselves and strive for greatness.
Next question comes from Daphne Linus. She's also an assistant coach here at Keystone, graduated in 2020. What kind of academic support is available to your student athletes?
So for us, I feel we have a pretty in-depth program. We call it our CAP, K-A-P, Keystone Academic Program. And it's something I picked up about 14 years ago and have adapted over the time and as we brought in. And one of the big things it's meant for is to really kind of help with the transition with a high school student with two main areas. It's communication, but the main one is really time management. And those are the two things that when a student comes into college that they struggle with the most. My background's in academics. I was a teacher. You know, I've taught all different levels from elementary to junior and senior high, U.S. history. I've taught at college. I've been an academic coordinator different places. So I use those kind of experiences to see where some of the trouble is. We see where the transition is. So for our program, we really try to drive home that aspect. The time management, the prioritization. We want to open up the communication with the professors. So obviously there's study halls, you know, we push them for tutors, but those are part of it. To me, those are parts of a program rather than not a program. So we meet with them weekly with their CAP book. We follow up with their professors. We make sure we follow up with them during this, you know, COVID time. You know, we do normal class checks anyway, like 8 o'clock in the morning, 9:30 class in the morning. We're out there near admissions, checking them in, make sure guys are going to class. Well, now that we've gone virtual, and even last spring we would do virtual class checks. So they have to jump on a Zoom before they go on to their virtual class. And then because we want to make sure we give the in-person aspect, there's a lot of what we did this semester where we called our virtual workrooms, where we would get a classroom signed out and bring our guys that we knew were a little bit, you know, had a little issue or you know, a little bit trouble doing the online from their room. You know, obviously there's a lot of distractions there. So we would sit them in a room and they would do their Zoom in a class, sitting in a classroom with a coach there. So we have a lot of different pieces to our part. And I would put our academic program up against a lot of schools and programs from that standpoint.
Next question also comes from Ashley. Do you have any pregame superstitions?
Oh boy, I guess be nervous. You know, that still doesn't shake. I think no matter what, I think, you know, that's something that, you know, I don't know if it's a ritual or superstition, but if I'm feeling nervous, I feel pretty good about it. And it's just, you know, just keep the guys loose. You know, that's something always, you know, we'll obviously have a team meal that morning and, you know, whether or not we're traveling or not and get them there. And obviously we have a pregame routine. And then after that, it's in the hands of the players and we turn it over to them and watch and have fun.
Next question, Harley Laubach. How many players are you looking to bring in each year?
So that's a great question because I think that goes to the heart of kind of how we built the program and kind of doing it the right way. You saw on the core slide where we talked about the process. So one of the things when I first looked at the job and I talked to a lot of people that started football programs, you know, the concept behind them was, hey, bring in 120 guys, you're going to lose half. And that's how you keep your 60 in that first year. And I just couldn't do it that way. That goes against everything we talked about from a development standpoint. So we wanted to make sure we brought in the right number where you can feel the team, still be on the field like we were in 2019, but also not be too big so we can, as coaching staff, be hands-on with them. So our first year, we targeted the number of 70, 75, and we actually ended the season. You always lose guys. Unfortunately, that's college sports, you know, regardless of the sport. You always lose people. So we ended up, you know, finishing the season with 61 guys that first year after, you know, starting in, you know, the 70, 75 range. So we got our 60, but gave a higher percentage kids a better experience that way. And then we came into this year with a target of 90 to 95, again, knowing that we were young and wanting to be hands-on to develop that. So I don't see us ever being a roster that's going to be ever too big. I could see us, once we kind of plateau out over these first few years, being in the 110 range. But we always want to try to shoot for that 30, 35 every recruiting class. That's why, I mean, we might have some dips in the, you know, valleys and, you know, rises in these first couple of years. But we want to make sure you always have that strong senior class that you can keep 4 years down the road.
Next question comes from Krista. How do you keep your students motivated to keep pushing every single day? And is there a certain mantra you always tell them?
Well, I think, you know, just trying to change up. We like routine, but we want to make sure we change up a little bit to where they understand what's coming, but they don't get bored of things. And I think in terms of trying to get them to just excel, like we talked about the one day, one brick. And I think they really thrive on that and the things kind of associated with it, whether it be directly or indirectly. And so we want to make sure that, you know, as we hold them accountable, we hold them quite accountable, we remind them of where they want to get to. We talk about them setting those long range, short term, you know, and short range goals, where they're at with it, have them basically identify to us, what have you done to work towards it? What have you done that has not worked towards it? We need to change. So I think it's that kind of that self accountability and having them just understand where they're at and then looking to catch the guy ahead of them, or, you know, make sure that they're helping the team out, whether it be GPA goal or whether it be, you know, making sure I get my hours community service wise or going on the field and catching all the balls or making sure I do the drills right.
Next question comes from Ashley again. I think you went to this a little bit before. Who's your favorite NFL team?
I'm a Cowboy fan, so I get a lot of heat in this part of the country, especially. You know, we have a lot of Eagles and Giants fans on the team, so I am a Cowboy fan. It's a struggle, though. Jerry Jones is the owner. Tough.
Next question comes from Doreen. Will we have to buy tickets to see a game?
Yeah, so we will have a gate, you know, where we will charge admission to come in. You know, our schedule next year is not finalized because of how some conferences are keeping 20 and moving it. Some went right to 21. We know pretty much who our opponents are going to be. We're actually just working on the, you know, home and away piece, and maybe the potential of an addition, you know. And then once that gets finalized, we get closer to September, and it will probably be, you know, more so in July, we'll end up, you know, putting out there kind of what the pieces of, you know, how you get tickets, and it will be at the gate or ticket or how you get them in advance. We'll get all that information out.
Next question here, this goes to the coaches. What are your typical game day rituals?
I've been listening to the same playlist since college, and I drink a lukewarm orange Gatorade and fix the mythical helmet issues that I have in before the game.
Myself, I make sure I got it every Friday. I got to get a purple Powerade. If I don't have a Powerade, I feel like the whole day is going to be bad. And then I think every coach has that ritual. If you're wearing something, you know, if you win, you keep wearing it every week. If you lose, you got to change the wardrobe. So that's kind of how I am. I put on a pair of black socks and orange shirt. And if I lose, I might change the shirt white. And put on another pair of different black socks. So in the locker room, I say a prayer with our skill guys. That's kind of been a thing I've done everywhere I've gone. And then I talk CO offense and get them fired up and ready to go and let Coach Higgins have them after that.
I don't know if I have any superstitions, but one thing I do on game day a lot is make sure the cameras have full battery about 1,000 times before I actually give them to the filmers. But I doubt that, turn them on, make sure it's full battery, check all the batteries, and then turn them off about too many times probably.
And another question from Doreen here. Tell us a fun fact about yourself.
We'll have the assistants go on this, is I think what she was, these guys can go. I don't have anything fun about me.
I don't know. I can still do no hand backflips at 36 years old. Kids ask me about it all the time. I haven't done it yet though.
I can play the bass guitar.
I guess a fun fact about me, I don't want to tell many people this, but I was actually in a movie when I was a kid. I was 9 years old. I was actually in a Wet Hot American Summer as an extra. So I guess that's my little fun fact I don't tell many people, but I was in a movie as a kid.
Nice. Question from Dane here. Do you think Keystone will win a championship before the Cowboys?
Well, yes, I got it. That's hopefully a good likelihood on that one. That's a good question, Dane. Yeah. So I hope so.
Looks like I don't see any more questions trickle in here, Justin. So that might wrap up the Grill the Coach segment. Another one from Doreen, the assistant coaches. Who are your favorite NFL teams?
Me, I don't have an NFL team. I like players. I tell guys all the time, I'm not an NFL guy. I'll watch it, but I like players. So if one of my better players are on a different team, I'll root for them. But I don't per se have a stake in any team in the league.
I'm a Titans fan.
Yeah, I'm a Minnesota Vikings fan.
Well, everyone on the chat, thanks for all your questions. You did a really good job today. Appreciate the feedback. I'm going to throw it back to Adrian here, who's going to give away some prizes.
Thank you guys for joining us today. And also thank you, Ryan, for hosting. And thank you, coaches, for joining us and sharing a little bit more and an insight into your program. Before we get to the prizes, I do just have a few quick announcements. If you are ever interested in donating to KC football, you see they're doing a lot of great things. There is an opportunity through our iDonate link. That will be shared in the chat, but also it's always on the KC Athletics homepage. Also, the Alumni Association is currently doing another activity where they are selling KC Strong gear. And if you are interested, that link is also now in the chat. And then lastly, the KC Day of Giving is Tuesday, December 1st. So if you are interested in that, please mark your calendars. But now sort of what we've been waiting for is the prizes. To win a prize, you must type your answer in the chat along with your email address because we will follow up through email. And also it's the first chat with the correct answer and their email address who will get the prize. So our first prize opportunity is a set of passes to our 2021 homecoming. And this is valued at roughly $200. So it's passes for the entire weekend. So the first question is, what is the first thing the coaches look for when recruiting? So again, the question is, what is the first thing that the coaches look for when recruiting? Remember, we need your answer and we need your email address.
Got it. Doreen put one in there. Yep. Good person.
Okay.
Is that the answer there?
Coach? So my what I was looking for was the core values or fit.
So I think Chris might get it there. Yeah.
Coach Higgins, you want to be the judge on that one?
No, I don't want to be. Can I say no? Is that allowed? because they all did a great job listening and put it down. All those are correct in my opinion. So I'm going to waffle on this and back out if I'm allowed.
Dom's the recruiting coordinator.
Put me on the spot.
Yeah, exactly.
Dom as the recruiting coordinator. Good person, core values, or fit?
Fit.
Fit. All right. So that would be Dane. All right. So then our next one, same thing. You're going to write your answer, and you are going to also have your email address. Our next prize is a basket of KC gear. So this is valued at $100. And this question is, what is the KC football slogan or the motto that all of the coaches said? And yes, we already have an answer, and that would be Daphne Lemus. All right. Thank you guys again for coming today and joining us. Also, thank you for participating and putting all of your chats in. And we really appreciate it. So we hope to see you come to an event next year.
We'll get Doreen snuck in there too. So we can get a shirt to Doreen too.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Doreen.
Absolutely.
All right. Thank you guys and have a great day.
Thanks, everybody. Have a great Thanksgiving too.
Thank you very much for everyone joining.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you, guys.